reflection of what we did last year. And last year we invited all of you here to tell you about the new setup of our office and how we are now organized in order to serve the Greek shipping community in a much better way. And what we want to show you today is first what we promised to you exactly last year, where we are now, and if we have fulfilled our promise, and also the new stuff which we are trying to serve the Greek shipping community. Now, the good news is that yes, we have fulfilled our promise, and I do not want me personally to say this to you. I want the people who really sweat and hard work to show it to you, because they deserve so. So these are the people you will see now, and they will address you, are the ones who are really working behind the scenes. I am more the one who cuts the red ribbon. Okay, all right, so first of all, I introduce to you George Dariakidis, which you all know, to start.
Okay, thank you. Good morning from my side as well. You're supposed to be also a little bit relaxed, so if you have any questions, please raise them while we have myself and everyone else the presentations. Copy at the back and everything you need, so feel relaxed. It's supposed to be at the end of the week, so we can be a little bit...
So, George, just to interrupt you, we have the pleasure also today to have Eric Mikus together with us. Eric, if you can stand up. So Eric is our representative in MEPC. And since there are a lot of burning issues regarding ballast water, MRV, etc., this is a very good chance to ask also questions regarding that, if you have. Okay. The only thing is that Eric will be leaving us in half an hour because he has to catch a plane. Okay, so if there is something, please, let's say your first question is to be addressed to Eric. And then to us. Okay, thank you.
On top of that, if you have any specific things and you don't have the time, by all means, via email and electronically, Eric will be able to respond to whatever you need, clarifications or whatever else you need.
Should I, if I may just mention one thing, I'm here by accident, actually, because I was here for business reasons yesterday, but grabbed the opportunity. And unless you haven't already caught it, one thing I would like to draw your attention to is what happened in the European Parliament yesterday. Yeah. For those who follow the CO2 issues, you should know that the Environmental Committee of the European Parliament yesterday agreed that shipping should be included in the European carbon trading scheme. It's not a final decision. This final decision will be made in plenary in most likely February. But if this goes through, then the EU will wait until 2021 for the IMO to do something. If the EU is not happy with what's happened at the IMO, then the EU will put a scheme in place to be operational by 2023. And this will, of course, have big impact on shipping. So it was all over the news very early this morning as well. So it's easy to pick up information, but if you need further input on that, I'll be more than happy to provide you with the details. So just, you know, latest hot fact from Brussels, and that's another one. Thank you.
Eric, thank you. We'll provide you with the exact name, so you will not you'll be able to contact him or via us, by all means. So, like Yanni said, last year we had promised some things. It was more or less same time as we do this year. Well, basically, we have promised you some stuff. So I'm here basically to remind you roughly what we had said that time. And then basically, Loizos Saias, who's sitting over there, and who's been in charge of this initiative, will tell you basically what we have done, actually. So have we achieved what we said? And then Nikos Kakalis, the red tie, will basically give you some highlights of 2016. Something that we want to share with you that we believe are quite interesting or beneficial for the greater good. So starting with what we promised basically last year, we said that there is a decision centrally from our organization to have Greece as the third home market around the world. As you know, DNV GL is the merger of a Norwegian and a German classification society. So it's only natural that we have two home markets as such, Germany and Norway. And it was decided that Greece should become the third one. So basically, why was that decided? These are actually exactly the same slides as last year. So I want to reflect a little bit exactly what we said last year. Because we have the Greek own fleet, it's the largest in the world. It's also the youngest. And as we have seen and we have predicted in the years past, the Greek owners are very active. Yes, new buildings are not that many, and we've seen this year. However, in sale and purchase, Greeks have been the most active around the world. They have spent a quite large amount of money buying ships and selling, for that matter. So the Greek maritime community is the one with the largest potential for our organization. And what does it mean? I mean, we say, it sounds very nice. Greece will become the third home market. It has, there are some important words there, but what does it mean? We had promised basically five things. That we're going to set up a global network of Greek-speaking employees to serve our Greek customers and potential customers as well. We said that we're going to have the directors for bulk carriers and tankers stationed in Piraeus. Segment director is basically, there are people who are responsible for the specific segment, tanker, bulk carrier, and so forth. And they have a global coverage. So we said they will be stationed in Piraeus. Then we said we're going to have a date center in Piraeus. Date is a service where we provide immediate response electronically to our clients for all technical questions. So if there is a technical question coming in from a customer, then these centers, which are scattered around the world, there are five of them, they take this request and they reply them directly, quickly, within a few hours, that is. And we said that we should have one in Piraeus, to have Greek employees replying to Greek customers. And we also said that we have already an established research and development center here in Piraeus, which was headed and still headed by Nikos Kakalis. And we said we're going to make it more commercial. So swing a little bit from the research and development activities more into the advisory, beyond class activities and so forth. And last but not least, we said that we're going to reinforce our office in order to have more control, more decision making, in order to show to our customers that we can take local decisions from here. Okay. And, sorry, last but not least, geographical expansion. The Piraeus will be responsible for a large geographical area as well. More responsibility there is, and so forth. So, we wanted to emphasize the importance of Greek shipping, which we all know is very important, and it is very important for our organization as well. We wanted to have concrete actions, last year that is, that will provide technical support and communication, which means support our clients on technical issues quickly and in with a Greek flavor. And we wanted to differentiate, that was our hope, that basically that we will give some benefits that the others do not provide, and assistance at the same time towards our owners, that they can feel that here, this office in Piraeus, is their home. They feel like their home. They are, DNV GL can serve them in the best way. Lastly, because we live in Greece and we're going through some tough times, all of us, and we all know it and feel it, we believe that this should also show that we are also investing in Greece. We're not saying, no, we forget Greece because of the problem, but we invest in Greece, Greek brain power, today, with concrete action. Okay? So this is what we promised last year. Obviously, we did something. That's why you're here. So I'll hand it now to Loizos, who has been heading this project and driving it through different actions in order to tell you basically what we actually did and where we stand today.
Thank you, George. The first thing I wanted to say is that, good morning to everybody, you didn't see that already. The first thing I wanted to say is to add a bit on what Ioannis said. Ioannis said that some people around are sweating. And in my presentation, I will mention some more names of other colleagues who are really sweating a lot. There is a lot of effort behind this initiative, and not only in this office here in Greece. The initiative is working all around the world. So when a Greek ship is visiting actually a station in Brazil or a station in China, the people who are attending the ship, they know about the initiative, they take care about our clients, and this is what we are aiming at. And the results are actually shown here and there, all around the world. The initiative has a 5-year perspective, and we have set a target to increase our market share in this in Greece by 20% by the end of the strategy period by 2020. And we have the project is composed of 5 pillars, as you can see here, and this is actually what George has presented last year as our promises. This picture also reminds a bit of Acropolis. Eh? It's the pillars, and this is the Aetomai sculpture, the top. So the picture also reminds of the initiative in Greece. I will give you some more details of the different pillars. We have been running this initiative for 1 year, and I'm glad to say that the results are very good. We have increased our market share, just to give you some numbers. The number of ships with DNV GL class in this market increased from about 700 to 750, which represents an increase of 7%. This actually is a good number. It's a good percentage increase with efforts of 1 year. And also in this very competitive market. This market is very competitive. It's very tough to gain market share in Greece. And we are very proud of that. And very important, equally important, is the clients appreciate what we are doing, and the clients and the market are very happy with the achievements. If we look at the different pillars, the first one is the placement of Greek surveyors all around the world. We have increased the competence here in Piraeus on plan approval, pre-contract, advisory, and other services with 6 people. And we have also employed 9 people all around the world. I will particularly underline we are placing ships in operation surveyors, fleet in service surveyors around the world at strategic locations to serve the Greek ships. I can mention Houston, Antwerp, Rotterdam, Dubai, Singapore, and 3 locations in China. These locations are very strategic, and we want Greek surveyors actually to attend the Greek ships when they are surveyed in these locations. And this is already in place. And of course, another important issue, new buildings have been reduced lately, but for whatever is there out with DNV GL class for Greek owners, we try to put, we discuss with the owners and see what they want. If they want a Greek project manager, we can arrange that. If they want an expatriate, we can arrange that. So we try to fulfill the client's requirements with competence and specialization depending on the project. We are really putting a lot of effort in the marketing and business development in this market. George is heading our business development team, which has been considerably strengthened. And there are already in this room a couple of key account managers who are really sweating, who are really doing a good job. And this is full thanks to them as well. We are cooperating a lot with new building locations in China and Korea for the benefit of the Greek projects, and which is appreciated by the customer, and it pays off actually. And we are monitoring quite a lot the second-hand changes of ships, so that we can contact the clients and help them and facilitate the changeover process. Next pillar is date. Date, I think in English, it can be misunderstood of something else, dating boys and girls. We are not doing that. That's not our business. Date starts from direct access to technical experts. We have a unit established here in Greece, and actually it's doing very well. It's offering on the spot and immediate assistance to difficult questions, let's put it this way, to questions with, yes, please.
Which are the most frequent, let's say, questions, or the most, things that are very, very common among ship owners.
Yes, I will just underline this one here. There are a lot of questions around class systematics, solas, MARPOL, and machinery things. If I can mention some, for example, because of not availability of shipyards, a ship may require an extension of the certificates. So that one is handled through date. Or, for example, Friday evening, we get a question, is the ship able to load this particular cargo? And we have to respond immediately for the chartering of the vessels. It has happened to me many times, Friday evening, to get these questions and get the answer within 4 hours. This one, we shall mention that we have, like in Piraeus, date stations in Houston, in Hovik, in Norway, in Hamburg, in Piraeus, and we have Singapore. These locations are covering 24/7. So it has happened to us many times. If we get a question Friday evening, the response will come from Houston. During the day, the response will go from this office here, direct to the client. And what is important to underline here is this personal touch. By having these experts here in this office, if there is a difficult question, let's say, maybe we just sit down over the table, drink a cup of coffee and discuss the problem. This is more direct than just the email. Here I will mention the manager of the unit here. It's Stefanos Tsiopanas, and he's doing a very good job with his team. This one here is, as George mentioned, we are focusing on research and development, but not just for the sake of research. We want to produce useful deliverables which can be used in the local market. The unit is headed by Nikos Kakalis. He will be presenting next, and with his team, and really they are doing a first-class job. Just to mention Cosmos here, it's a baby which has been developed here in the Piraeus and it is used worldwide, and Nikos will give us some more information. Also important to note is joint development projects with the industry. We work with clients on new designs, on new developments, on new technological achievements, and we end up with specifications for new ships, for new technology, new developments. So this is this element here. And of course, with research, we promote advisory services in the local market. Last one is reinforcement of this local office. As all of you know, next year we are going to have the implementation of the ballast water management systems. From next year, we have MRV, so there is going to be a lot of workforce required to achieve this from the classification point of view. We strongly believe that these things are best done on a local basis, so we are strengthening the plan approval teams here. This is important to note. Andreas Pangalos has been appointed to be a chief surveyor. He's fully functional now in this office. We have in DNV GL 3 chief surveyors, one in Hovik, one in Hamburg, and one in Piraeus, in the three home markets. And the task of the chief surveyor is to immediately handle difficult problems, which may even go beyond our rules, find clever solutions to satisfy requirements and the clients. And this is actually working very fine. With the presence of the chief surveyor in Greece, it helps a lot. And last but not the least, we are cooperating a lot with local institutions. Eric here was with me yesterday having a session with the Union of Greek Ship Owners about environmental issues. And these things we promote and the market appreciate. Not to mention also cooperation with Martecma, Helmepa, etc. So that's all. I don't know if there is any question on these things or later. Okay, then Nikos Kakalis will present the next.
Thank you very much, Loiso. Good morning also from my side. Before we enter into more details here, as my colleague said, everything is done and your ship day is actually coming from two worlds, teamwork and collaboration. with our colleagues and between our management. So in the last part of our presentation today, we would like to share with you some of the key competencies that we have developed here in Piraeus and that are relevant to both topics of our maritime industry today. First, I would like to start with ballast water management. So the convention was ratified something like 3 months ago, which means that by September next year, something like 6,000 ballast water management plans for DNV GL classed ships will need to be in place. So a lot of effort and a lot of tasks for our customers. In MRE, in our region alone, we are talking about 1,000 plans for our customers. And in order to have the capability to cover this need, we have already trained 8 approval engineers here locally in Piraeus. After that, gradually we will have the uptake of retrofitting of ballast water management treatment systems in the next 5 years or so, and this will generate even more approval requirements regarding piping and electrical systems and so on and so forth. And in order to have the capability to serve locally our customers, we have already arranged to have competence here in our Piraeus office. So a massive task for our customers and also a lot of good opportunity from our side to support them effectively and efficiently. Before we move on, just like to mention that in our digital mydnvgl.com portal, our organization is already starting setting up an application that will be able to support our customers with compiling their ballast water management plans. And in that way, we will have enabled a more efficient approval procedure that will reduce the administrative burden internally and externally for the benefits of our customers and in particular big stakeholders. Next is MRV, monitoring, reporting and verification. We know that the regulation from the European Commission on MRV means that from January 2018, all ships above 5,000 gross tonnage that call to EU ports will need to report their annual CO2 consumption. That means that something like 4,000 DNV GL class vessels will fall under this regulation, and we are talking about 600 ships in our region. And not only that, but 1 year later, IMO will be adopting a similar scheme, meaning that the annual reporting of CO2 emission will become global, and therefore we will have something like another 12,000 DNV GL class vessels that will need to enter under this regulation. From those 1,500 ships that are from our region, will need also to come into this regime. What we are doing in order to be ready to support our customers even from today is that we will provide verification of the MRV monitoring plans and the emission report from here, from Piraeus. And not only that, we are already providing advisory services in order to assess what is the MRV readiness levels of our customers so that they are well prepared to support their operation when it comes to MRV. And these advisory services are offered from Piraeus again. Finally, our organization has already developed a software suite that is called Navigator inside MRV, and this suite is able to cover fully from end to end the MRV needs of ship owners and ship managers. The next one, cybersecurity. This is an issue that is heavily addressed nowadays. We know that cyber technology, or in more hazy terms. Internet-related technology has changed our world. Internet actually has changed the way we live, we act, and we live our daily lives. Equally, ships are changing and are becoming more and more connected. And our vessels have smarter systems that are based on automation, based on control and electronics. This is fantastic, and this makes our first life much better. However, this at the same time opens the door to cybercrime, which drives cybersecurity to becoming one of the biggest challenges of our industry today. The vulnerabilities that we see when it comes to cyber threats relate to navigation, communication, bridge, control systems, and also any other third-party external equipment. We are following in DNV GL a pragmatic approach, and we have developed a certain range of services that can provide assistance to ship owners in order to manage efficiently the cyber-related risks. We offer a self-assessment application in our digital portal, mydnvgl.com. They can run a very quick assessment, completely free of charge, in order to see what is the level of cyber-related readiness they have in their organization. And then we are also offering a much more in-depth assessment of their cyber-related procedures that include onboard and also offshore audits. Then we offer competence and awareness building, e-learning and training, and very importantly, information security management system preparation. Finally, verification of this system against the ISO 27001, penetration testing, so we have people that can go on board with their laptops and their equipment. What they can do is that they can throw virtual cyber attacks on the vessel and estimate what is the resilience of the vessel and their procedures against this cyber attack. So DNV GL has all this technology and offers it for the benefit of our customers. All these things ultimately lead a company to certification against ISO 27001. And I would like to say that as Greeks, we are proud that the first pioneering projects of DNVGL in this area started from this office with three major Greek ship owners. Next, as my colleague said before, we have a very strong research and development unit here in Piraeus. A center of excellence for developing new services and new technologies when it comes to ship machinery systems. And what I'd like to focus today is this Cosmos platform. We have developed Cosmos, which is actually a software suite that we use in order to build virtual engine rooms in the computer. And we use this platform and this virtual models in order to simulate and optimize machinery with respect to energy efficiency, emissions, costs, and safety. And out of this technology that DNV GL has developed in Piraeus, now we use it in order to offer and deliver a range of consulting services to ship owners here in Greece and around the world. For instance, we do techno-economic comparison of alternative configurations and solutions for new buildings and retrofitting. We use it in order to do advanced performance assessment and fuel consumption improvement for existing vessels. And also nowadays, Cosmos is the backbone of DNV GL in assessing the potential from the introduction of new technologies and solutions in shipping. Finally, we have run successful projects with over 60 vessels already, with owners sitting here in Piraeus and abroad globally. Finally, innovation is in the genes of DNV GL. And I would like to close our presentation today with
a touch of innovation and to talk about drones. It's a common knowledge that drones have started being widely available to provide possibilities for video documentation of areas that are more difficult to access for normal inspections and maintenance. And for that reason, DNV GL has been investing a lot in order to test many types of drones in different types of vessels, so that we see their capabilities in a variety of enclosed compartments. The benefits that we see that are arising from the introduction of drones have to do with eliminating the risk of damage to coating from staging, improved time and cost savings, and also improved safety for surveyors. So the plan is that drones and people that have the competence to use drones in survey will be available soon in Piraeus as well. So thank you very much, and now we are ready.
You can mention how many surveys we have carried out with drones. That we have carried out about the drone surveys, which is a very popular topic. It's worth mentioning that we're not just trying it out. We have actually worldwide used it in about 6 or 7 actual surveys, where actually the survey itself was carried out by a drone, or part of the survey. So we have gone beyond the testing and trying out, and we put it in actual production.
You don't think that the drones will replace surveyors or to reduce the number of surveyors needed for a survey?
Not to be honest, but we think that it will make the survey much faster and more efficient, and therefore less costly and safer for the surveyors.
Can I just add something here? To do the close-up surveys on a very big tanker, for example, just to put some numbers on the process, it takes several hundreds of thousands of US dollars to do the close-up inspections. Maybe that's an effort of a few weeks' work, and at the end of the day, we confirm that there is no problem on the ship. And that money between us is flushed down the toilet. But somehow we have to reach these structures and assess the condition. So drone, for example, is a very good case. It's very quick, very cheap, you can do it. And you know, these hundreds of thousands of dollars can be used elsewhere on the ship to really improve the safety standard of the ship. That's a good example.
On top of that, I would add that the drone, no matter if maybe in the future will be smart and will not need a driver, but you will still be seeing things that needs to be assessed by somebody. So it's not a point of reducing server, it's a point of saving cost, reducing cost actually, saving money that is, and making things easier, more efficient, quicker. You know that the shipping market now is faster, more dynamic, turnaround times are much more small, so you need higher efficiency. So it's basically a new tool that comes out of the use of technology.
And to add to that, the drones we are using are actually tailor-made.
Yes.
So they have developed them in-house. I think the cost is about 15,000 to 20,000 euros.
At least for the first version of that.
The first version. We took some from the market and we developed them further in order to be fitting the purpose. For your information also, there will be a digitalization day in Piraeus, and we are planning to do it in April. Our organization is spending every year 5% of the annual revenue in research and innovation. And we want our customers to see that, and we want also the customer's feedback. And we want to see also the relevance of our research to the customers. So what we're planning to do is to bring from around the world all the experts and researchers who are doing these jobs here in a kind of show where everybody will be able to go and see a drone and see it flying be there with the people who have developed that in order to actually see what is the feedback from the market,
and also for us to show to the market that we are actually spending this money for a good cause.
All these things are very interesting. I would like to ask if the technologies and the services which are developed in-house here in Greece, in Piraeus, are planned to be exported to other DNV markets, which is the natural step forward.
There's no, you answered the question.
Do you have any such examples already?
Yes. In the Cosmos, which started from here, we developed in Piraeus. Now we have projects in other 8 countries, I think.
Yes, and all around the world.
So US projects in Korea, projects in China, projects in also Europe have been started
with
Cosmos, with customers from outside. And of course, as you said, it's natural, and we will not have it here only.
Yeah.
It's not only good for the Greek shipping, it's good for overall shipping. Okay. But it's we are proud that actually we started here. Okay. And we want actually to continue in that role.
Yeah, because it's important also for the home countries, Norway and Germany, to be able to witness the results of the shipping strategy towards Paris.
Of course. It's actually, we are kind of example, let's say, for the rest of the world.
Actually, to emphasize the things that Nikos and Yanis have been saying, Nikos, correct me if I'm wrong, but the research and development unit, when it was first started in Paris, was the first unit outside of actually Oslo.
Yeah.
Be created
in 2008.
In 2008, and the idea was it was created in Piraeus to try it out, test what would happen if we have a research and development unit outside of central head office, where you have a large community of ship owners, where you could have cooperative projects and jobs and so forth, in order to develop them and take them back for the rest of the world.
Just to close now and. Continue with your question. The main message is that where our competition is being reduced, we have invested. And we have promised last year to grow, and actually we are growing. And we will continue in that path. That is the main message of today. So please now feel free to ask questions.
What will be your main plans for next year? In terms of enhancing this
Look, I mean, if you have planned something and you execute it and you find actually that you get results from it, you don't change the plan. You actually just do it even more to get more harvest, more of the benefits. So the plan is that actually we will continue what we said at more. Okay. There is a plan also this year. As I said last year, we presented today, we hired from Greek people, spread around the organization around the globe and also here in Piraeus. This will continue partly now, also in 2017, but it will be reduced because, I mean, we are where we wanted to be, but we will continue. There will be a few more hires in. But it will be more specialized.
How many hires was that last
year? Well, it was in total, the placements were 18.
Replacements, you say?
The placements. Ah. Placements were 18. And,
so that was new personnel, 18 people?
Yes, new personnel dealing with Greek shipping.
And have you also redistributed personnel from other DNV GL offices to work other periods?
Yes. I mean, that is including the redistribution of people.
Okay.
But at least now they are taxed here.
So net new hires, how
Net new hires from outside the organization, you mean?
Yes.
I think we're talking about 9 or 10 people.
Something like that.
Yes.
You've also said you went from 700 ships last year, about 700 to about 750.
704 end of 2015 to 748, I mean, if I want to be exact.
These new 44, were the new buildings from existing customers?
This is a combination. However, because you know you have people, vessels which are scrapped, vessels which are having deliveries from new buildings, the majority is coming from resales. Greeks who are buying vessels, DNV GL vessels, from foreigners, from outside Greece, which do not change class now, but remain with us. We had also a lot of tokas and transfer of class from vessels here locally, but mainly that is what has changed the perception of the Greek shipping, that we are very expensive. We're not very expensive anymore. We are very competitive, actually. And that has changed also, and that's why we have safeguarded what we had from coming from outside in.
You mentioned what market share does that represent, the 750? I'm asking this because it's part of your long-term plan.
Because I knew the question was coming. So for the, it was in GRP terms last year it was 15.2%, and now this corresponds to 16% of the Greek market.
That's within 11 months, basically.
Yes, but all this data, and that's why we didn't put it also in the presentation. There's many creative ways of doing it. Okay. And as you know, everybody that does it in a kind of creative way to serve their own purpose. And that's why we didn't want to... But that's why we had it ready.
We love numbers.
The net fact is that we have seen an increase in the numbers. We have, like Yanis just mentioned, at least in terms of gross tonnage, and that's also reflected in deadweight and number of vessels. And this comes from basically the satisfaction that we see from owners, and we're seeing from the satisfaction because we receive it verbally, and we receive it also in terms of whoever buys DNV GL ships, now they retain.
Do you think that all these new regulations and changes of requirements of vessels and inspections and all that stuff will actually help you in develop your business further? I mean, we have the ballast, we have the MRV, we have the sulfur coming in changes in 2020. There's a lot of things in a space of 3 or 4 years.
Well, if I want to make a general comment...
Are you lobbying for these changes?
Trying to get an overview, yes, that is, let's say, helping the whole cycle to move. Okay, so the whole industry is moving because of these new regulations. However, I have to say, sometimes, and because I have been, my past is coming from ship owners, it's part of me, for me it's painful. Because what I want to see, personally, I want to see if somebody is doing something, it has a value. And I think that some of the regulations are very controversial and have been, let's say, disputed very much if they actually contribute in a safer environment, less pollution, etc.
So you think it's making shipping more bureaucratic?
Well, I mean, if we want to be honest, the whole industry is over-regulated. That is the reality. And the old days have changed. I mean, now you have checklists have become a kind of a reality, an everyday reality, and actually it's a huge burden for the crews on board to cope with that. So instead of focusing the energy in the really things which matter, you focus your energy on filling up a checklist. Mm-hmm. Right, which I don't think that this should be. I mean, the energy should not be focused there. So we have actually a task as an industry to try to change that focus. How it's done, probably the latest, let's say, initiatives about, and also from Greek ship owners focusing on the human element, more I think it's very important.
The new regulations that come in, we are becoming a little bit the messenger. And the problem here is that the benefit, it's also a burden for us as is for the ship owner. If you have so many ballast water plants to approve, it's not that it will not affect us. We'll have to approve too many things within a short period of time. Somebody has to do it. We have to change our organization. We have to prepare ourselves. What we see, however, is that we are setting up ourselves now for a year in order to be able to support the ship owners better, to give them faster replies, to give them local support, to be able to talk to them, an employee from here, not from outside, to give them some advice, because at the end of the day, classification is also a lot of these things. yes, we deliver the certificates on board, but there is a lot of other things that we have to provide the shipowner. It's part of what they expect from us.
How difficult is your job from the fact that many of these new regulations are very controversial in themselves, in the fact that there is no standard procedure set by the authorities? For instance, in the CO2 monitoring schemes, I don't think that the EU has set up a specific process to be followed by the whole industry. I think this is up for debate still, and we're just 12 months away.
Well, that is the outcome of having different regimes, because every regime is giving their own kind of regulations. You have IMO, you have US Coast Guard, you have EU, which they have. You have port state controls, which sometimes they come and say they have their own interpretation. And of course, that creates a mess.
Exactly, that's
To tell you the truth, we hate that. We would like to have, let's say, one kind of set of rules applicable for home shipping everywhere.
How will you automate the process of the CO2 emissions that you mentioned in the presentation? I saw in one of the slides that DNV is planning to automate the process. Yeah. How are you going to do that? When no process is set...
No, there is. The European Union has come out with specific guidelines. There are still some details to be finalized. But there are instructions on how this will be made. So there is a framework and there are instructions. So this is how we are finding ways, like everyone else, to support the ship owners. But you are right that, and like Yanis said, when you have different regimes, there are different things happening at the same time. But when we are providing a solution, we're providing because there is also something that is a guidance. If there was no guidance, there is no way to support them.
Let's say for MRV, for your specific question, you have the EU MRV, then you have also IMO. All right. Actually, the solution we made is complying with both. Okay, and that is something important. And the applications we make, which a lot of them are free of charge, is to for the shipowner actually to understand where he is now and see what is the gap. And maybe for some, there's no need to do anything because some of them have already developed systems in-house. They don't need to actually go and buy something or do something. But being able to realize that is also very useful. Because then you avoid spending money. And we don't want our customers to spend money for nothing. Okay, and that is actually one of the policies that we have is we want whatever we do beyond class, our customers first to realize that they have a value on that. And of course, if you have a value, if the customer has a value, then of course, then when we talk business. Because business has to be win-win. Any other questions?
In 2017, you mentioned you mentioned that we have the implementation of ballast water treatment management convention, MRV rules. Do you think that Greek shipping will have the time to implement or to achieve the deadlines of these deadlines
regarding ballast
the IMO has to give an extension of the of these dates of implementation.
Well, at this moment, as you know, there is no decision made on the implementation schedule. MEPC 70, there were some proposals on the table, but there was no decision made. And everything was postponed for MEPC 71, which will happen May or June 2017, something like that. And according to the convention, 8th of September 2017 is the date where you have to comply. Well, isn't that short? The distance? I think it's extremely short, but I cannot represent by more and give you immediately now what will be the conclusion of that. This is something that we have to wait and see. Of course, the prudent thing to do is to do, if the flag allows, to do a decoupling and do the survey before 8th of September. Because we don't know what's going to happen and what will be the decision of the MEPC 71. However, again, I say that the distance between the decision and the implementation date, the convention date, is very short, extremely short, for the whole world fleet to comply with.
For ballast water treatment systems?
Yes.
You mean?
Yes. For MRV, I would say that I don't think it will be a problem in the implementation. It's actually something quite simple.
And from your look, it's unnecessary.
I cannot say it's unnecessary. I mean, this is international regulation now. Okay, IMO and EU. So
you're off the record.
What off the record?
I said from my point of view.
It's a new regulation, and many Greek shipowners, if you ask them, they're more or less, to our understanding, also ready to comply. Is it a very difficult regulation? Like Yanni said, no, it's not complicated. Is it on top of many others? Yes, it is.
Yes.
And as far as ballast water, we cannot say a lot of things, because if IMO does not come out with clear decisions on the proposals on the which are already on the table, and unfortunately, even ourselves, we are scratching our heads and waiting to see, because we cannot help up the owners if there are no decisions from IMO.
Can I add one comment here? I think this is going to be a wet process. It's like, let's think about ISM, when it first came in. What was this? How would we implement this? And we have seen the swing. First, the initial stages, we overdid it, all of us. The shipping companies, the classification societies, the consultancy companies. And then we all of us learn from each other as we go along. And then it settles to somewhere which is efficient, safety oriented. So this is another one of those things. It will take a process, and it will settle somewhere, which will be useful for the industry in the longer term.
Definitely, is a lot of changes and a lot of new rules. And as we said, yes, shipping is overregulated, you know. But somehow, as Loiso said, this will balance off at the end. Because, I mean, ships are needed. The world needs the ships to transport things. So they cannot put things where the ship owners cannot actually operate the ships. They have to find somewhere a balance point. And this will be found somehow. That is what experience has brought. How exactly this will happen, of course, is something we need to wait and see. But we need to be ready in order, and that is what we're trying to do here, in order to help the owners comply with a less painful way. I remember one more number, since you love numbers. We have also 62 new buildings which are on the way. So the 748 will be plus 62, of course. You know, new buildings at this moment, some of them may be cancelled, some of them may be delayed or whatever, okay. But in the order book, there are 62 Greek new buildings at this moment. With our class.
Yes, I know that you believe very strongly in digitalization, but I just wondered if you could say something about the extent to which Greek shipping and your clientele here has embraced digitalization compared with other markets. And does that depend to some extent on the trade?
I will, I can say as a quick reply that, repeat what Nico said, that globally, we like to believe that probably we are the first class society that has, for example, for cybersecurity projects and cybersecurity services towards our clients, we are the first ones that we have actual projects with customers. And these first projects, these are three, Nico?
Three.
These three first projects are actually coming from Greece, worldwide. So that shows partly how Greece is embracing this
And these are cybersecurity related problems.
Yes, yes,
yes. Yes.
Can I just add?
Yes, also Nikos as well. If I'm sure there are other examples.
I think in today's situation, a lot of I think the majority of our clients, they have a lot of data which is coming from the ship to shore, and there is manually fed into the system. There is automated data coming to the company. But it's a common situation. I think there is not much done to take advantage of this data and conclude business benefits which can be put back into the ships and the operation of the ships. So I believe that there is a lot of room for things to be done in the digitalization. In a nutshell, I would say we are drowning today in information, but that's as far as it goes. We don't go the next step to make sense out of this data and put it into use. So that's an area where we have to work together with the clients, and from our side, as Classification Society, we have a lot of data which we gather from the ships, which needs to be further processed and draw conclusions. What's the bottom line? What do we do with this data? So there is a lot of room for improvement.
And all the projects we are doing regarding this will be also presented in this digitalization day here at Piraeus, where you can come and see, face to face, what we are doing and discuss with the experts, and also we need also the feedback from the market in order to make sure that actually where we are heading to is actually the right thing. I mean, it will have an impact in the market because sometimes researchers can head their own way and sometimes are not, let's say, so relevant to the market. And we wanted to make it sure that it is relevant to the market.
Shall I also?
Yeah, please.
I think Nadja's question is a very relevant, very interesting one. And what Loiso said is, you have data. The important thing is not to acquire more and more data, but to have the capability to generate insights and value out of this data. So this is what DNV GL is investing in developing. And one very good example of the things that we are doing here is what we said before with Cosmos. So having big ship owners trusting DNV GL to generate computer models of their vessels and use the models together with data in order to assess the performance of the vessel and take actions based on these models in order to have tangible improvements in terms of fuel consumption, this is really a proof of what Greek shipping is doing when it comes to embracing new technologies and digitalization.
So actually Greek shipping is pioneers in that respect.
Yes.
It's a final comment from my side, if we try to analyze it a little bit. I mean, I think Greek owners have realized that there is certain things in the digitalization, digital services technology that are worth investing in, especially when it's going to make them more competitive. Cybersecurity, which I mentioned at the beginning, is starting to become one of the points that their customers, the charterers, are asking about. Services like Cosmos, where creating computer models and you can optimize your ship, is reducing their cost, is optimizing their operation, hence making them more attractive to their customers. So in these kind of services, ideas, ways that they can make them more competitive, we have seen that Greek shipping is investing and they're interested in at least looking into and exploring ways that they can make.
And if I am allowed to raise it one level higher, so digitalization is at the cutting edge of innovation in general. And if we are talking about innovation and Greek shipping, we have currently two Greek ship owners that are really pushing the limits ahead when it comes to innovation with two joint development projects we are running this year. Is Evan Green 2 with a gas lift, and also LP Green with consolidated marine management. So we see Greek shipping pushing the limits, trying to innovate, trying to sit together with DNV GL and other stakeholders like leading shipyards and come up with concept designs that can generate vessels that are more cost-effective, safer, and much better assets in the water. So yes, Greek Cyprus is leading the world, and from our side here in Piraeus, we do our best to support that.